I'm, first of all, really happy people came after the conference. Some people are like exhausted from the conference. Just 3 or 4 people. I was like, yes, I'm excited, I'm ready to go again. How many people here are excited for tonight's meetup? I'm guessing a little bit concerned. Like, Junius raises his hand, and Russell's like, oh. We were until the light guy came. And anyways, my name is Mike Stowe. Very quickly, my remote works here. I'm trying to destroy technology tonight. So if you're here earlier, I tried to break the projector and try to break my little clicky thingy. Literally broke my clicky thingy. There it goes. So the reason I want to do this talk is for myself. I consider myself an API fanatic. So I'm from the API side, and I was doing, you know, REST APIs and SOAP APIs. I don't know what SOAP APIs are. The other people are very brave, by the way, because they not only admit to it, but they raise their hands like, yes. And then as I started doing this, the customers I had at my last company were really saying, hey, this is great, but what happens if we have a spike on the API? What happens if, you know, a service goes down and we fall on the microservices side? And then, of course, the community guy at Tigera. Sadly, I'm not the director of communications, as you'll learn from my horrible presentation, but on the community side. How many people, by the way, know of Tigera or Project Calico? Awesome. Now, before I get started, how many people here work for an enterprise company? One person, all right. How many people here work with enterprise companies? A couple more people. How many people here work at a company? Perfect, okay. So, again, the focus of this talk is kind of what are the challenges that enterprises have and why, you know, when we talk about like microservices, we talk about moving this direction, what's the reason for it? And so it's not gonna be a super technical, here's Project Calico, I'm gonna leave that to Matt, who can go into all things Project Calico. More of a, if you're trying to convince your boss or if you're trying to explain why this is so important. By the way, this is Felix, this is our cat mascot. So, my other disclaimer I should throw out there really quickly is, I think I'm funny. And so I'm gonna apologize right now because I tell horrible jokes, I think they're funny, nobody laughs. The last conference I started with a joke, I actually got booed, which made me sad. So, apparently that's funny. Yeah. But I think the thing we look at today is that today enterprises are facing unprecedented threats, and I think we all know this. It's not just a threat when it comes to security, it's not just somebody doing a DDoS attack and taking down the internet. It's actually a threat from startups. It's a threat from new companies, it's a threat from new ideas. If you think about it, who is the world's largest taxi service? Anybody?
Uber.
Uber. And Uber kind of came out of nowhere. Guys said, hey, I'm gonna create an app, you can, you know, get a ride share, this would be fantastic. Most taxi companies weren't looking and going, wow, we need to make sure we have mobile apps for us to pick people up. Who is the company that Hilton, Marriott, and everybody else is now looking at as one of their biggest competitors and biggest threats? Airbnb, again, a company that just said, hey, let's just enable sharing and make this happen. In fact, several years ago, there was this tiny little startup that had this great idea of, let's take, you know, 5 good movies, make them streamable on the internet, and put a bunch of crappy movies on there. And this other company called Blockbuster said, that's a silly idea, that will never happen. And if I recall correctly, they had the opportunity to buy this small startup for like $12 million and said no. How many people know where, how many Blockbusters are open today? How many people know what this company is? I'm getting myself in trouble, I can't pick on them, but. If you look at it, between 1955 to 2014, so roughly 50 years, only 12% of Fortune 500s actually survived. Are actually still around. So we talk about how things are changing, transformation, it's happened very quickly. In fact, in 10 years, it's estimated that another 40% of those will no longer exist as a Fortune 500. So a huge change in the ecosystem. This means enterprises need a lot of different things. They need innovation, they need speed, they need scale, they need security and resiliency. Which is great because if you go talk to most enterprises, they're sitting there going, yes, we have SOAP libraries that we need to connect, and by the way, this is all part of my AS400 mainframe. How many people here have ever thought about starting their own company? A couple people, okay. How many people here have thought about using an AS400 mainframe with SOAP to do so? So we start to see a challenge here. And that's the problem, is that we're in what we call the digital transformation age. It's no longer about just changing, it's no longer just about budget, it's not about we're gonna have the most brick and mortar stores. It's literally disrupt or you will be disrupted. You know, you have an awesome company we'll pick on, DigitalOcean, who said, hey, look, we're gonna let you spin up a server for $5 a month. You know, that's pretty powerful and amazing compared to, you know, paying for heart surgery before. The other problem is that the number one issue is that companies need to have the speed of change. They need to move very quickly. And when they have these services, they have these large monolithic services that serve millions, if not billions, of customers. So when we talk about the scale and this need to change, they want to be able to take advantage of the same technologies that we have at the startup level, but they need to be able to process about 20 billion queries per hour, you know, and up to tens of billions of database transactions per month. So a lot of data, a lot of momentum. And all these things are mission critical. You know, if a system goes down, what happens? They lose millions of dollars. And that's a problem because it's no longer when you will be hacked and how to contain the breaches. And again, these are not small expenses. With Target, the point of sale hack cost them $252 million. Sony, $35 million just to do repairs to their IT infrastructure after being hacked. And Tesla, they actually haven't released a number, but we're guessing several millions for Tesla having their cars hacked and very quietly patching that and saying it's good to go again. And downtime also isn't cheap. You know, we're talking about $100,000 per minute is the average cost of downtime, with a data server outage being around $730,000. If you think about that, Delta, when they had their servers go down, lost $150 million in about 3 days. Dyn, when they had the DDoS attack, companies around the world lost billions and billions of dollars. And then Microsoft Live, you know, had some fun challenges in March when the server went down 9 times in less than a month and people started complaining, asking for refunds. So this thing's very, very expensive. So it's not just the scale, but they need the resiliency aspect. And the reality is, again, enterprises are not designed to meet these needs, which is awesome because you guys already know this stuff, and you're like, yes, this is why we're here. We're here to fix these problems. Again, they're stuck with legacy architectures, AS400 mainframes. They're using legacy COBOL. Any COBOL developers here? Just checking. They focus on people versus automation. They say, hey, we have to do something. Let's hire more people to solve the problem. How many people are programmers or developers? A couple people? When you have an issue, let's say you're right behind your deadline, how many of them say, let's see what we can cut and automate the processes, or some people say, let's just hire 10 more engineers because that'll make it go faster. Always works, right? And then, of course, legacy infrastructure. Actually, legacy infrastructure, at my former company, our CEO got up on stage, and he asked our customers, all large enterprises, you know, to raise their hands if they were buying parts for their infrastructure on eBay. And I'm sitting here in the corner laughing, like, nobody's gonna raise their hand for that. Half the room rose their hand and said, yes, we've had to buy parts on eBay because they no longer manufacture the parts we need to keep our systems maintained. So if you think about it again, these enterprises are going, hey, we've got all these systems. This is why I had to ask a couple of developers before I get myself in trouble. You know, this is the challenge. They're stuck in saying we have to maintain an AS400, we have to maintain a mainframe, we have to maintain a DB2, and we can't take advantage of these microservices. So they came with this idea of cloud native, which was this idea of having a modern distributed service system and this idea of being able to scale the system to tens of thousands of self-healing multi-tenant nodes. So all of a sudden said, look, you need resiliency. Well, what if it goes down and automatically restarts itself? You know, if we, you know, create containers and use services like Kubernetes, you know, on CoreOS. And of course, you want to scale tens of thousands of, you know, nodes is pretty significant. We actually scale with you as you grow. And so again, we have the idea of containers, dynamically managed, microservice oriented. And this is all really awesome because now all of a sudden, this is what enterprises exactly want. They want the ability to ship faster, they want to be able to reduce risk, they want to be able to increase efficiency, and they want teams to be able to do what they do best. They hire specialists, they hire, how many people are a PHP developer? Okay, I'm the only one, fantastic. You know, if you're a Java company, you hire a PHP guy, you don't want to say, okay, you take 6 months to learn Java just so you can work on this project. You say, you know PHP? We pity you, we feel kind of bad for you, quickly develop this in your container and get out there. And again, we'll be able to start and stop these services with little no consequence. Again, the goal is not only the auto-scaling architectures, but to decouple the monolithic applications that they have today so that they can have a modern architecture, they can use REST APIs, they can use dynamic APIs, they can use modern code such as Go, Python, automation over people, and of course, modern infrastructure such as AWS, CoreOS, DigitalOcean, I'll throw that one in there. And so it's designed to work autonomously, greater collaboration, and then greater transparency. It's actually designed to make it so we can work more closely together instead of having siloed groups. So again, replicate environments, which we all know with CI/CD, and then discoverability. Say, hey, you have these APIs, we have these microservices, easily discovered. How many people are absolutely bored out of their mind at this point? You guys are super kind, thank you. So this solves the problem, right? We got all taken care of. We have this idea of containers. Everything's fantastic. If anybody has seen my car, this is not my car. My car actually has black tape on the hood. It's really sad. But the problem is that there's no such thing as a silver bullet. And as we look at things and we say, we have, you know, Kubernetes, we have these containers, it's a huge step forward. But it's not necessarily a silver bullet because no matter what we do, if we do it incorrectly, it's become detrimental. And this brings us to, you know, the whole concept of microservices, nanoservices, mini-services. If you're saying, wait, what are nanoservices, what are mini-services? Those are the terms that the analysts are now saying, because like microservices is cool, but we go even a little deeper than microservices. We could have mini-services, we could have nanoservices, and then someone came up, I kid you not, and said, what if we had macroservices? So this is basically a service, again, designed to do one thing very well. It's designed to be self-contained, agile, and be abstracted by an API. And how many people here are for microservices? Yes, no? How many people are kind of on the fence of microservices? How many people are still awake? How many people like audience participation? Okay, you're killing me. So I'm a big proponent of microservices, and I think as we talk about containers and how their role in microservices, it's important to understand what microservices are very quickly. Look at microservices, they're gonna focus on business value. What can we do to provide value for the business over, what's the full technical strategy behind it? We wanna do strategic goals. We wanna have intrinsic interoperability. If I create a service, it should work with all services regarding the programming language and how they work. We should have shared services. We should be able to reuse them, compose them. It should be flexible. So we may not take all the time to optimize it and make it perfect, but we'll make sure it's flexible so that it can evolve over time and then, of course, evolve evolutionary refinement. You can make it better as we go versus having to have a waterfall methodology and have it be perfect. How many people think those are good areas of focus or good ideas? Nobody thinks it's a good idea. One person, okay. So these services should be loosely coupled, unassociated, self-contained, basically autonomous, and they do one thing or a couple things very well. Everybody's on board with that? Yes, sounds good. There's a problem with this. How many people have heard of service-oriented architectures? How many people like service-oriented architectures? And how many people are saying, wait, I thought we were going to microservices. Why are we talking about service-oriented architectures? The reason is these are the exact same definitions. If you look at it, we all just said this is a great idea, but that comes from the SOLA manifesto. So we have to look and understand, you know, as we move to containers, we move these services, what makes it different from having a whole bunch of services that are gonna complicate things more significantly? And it's something I like to refer to as the glue problem. With the glue problem, what we like to do is we like to build a whole bunch of applications and stick them together, and we say this is super awesome because now I'm using an API and that's not gonna cause any problems. Except for companies that have been using SOAP APIs for years, and all of a sudden to really pull out a SOAP API and change their architecture, it's $12 million to do so. So if we think about it, as these systems grow and as we focus on containers and microservices, as they grow, they become more complex. If you think of Legos, it's very easy when you have two Legos to pull those Legos apart. It's very easy when you have three Legos to pull the one Lego off, pull the other one, put it back on, we're good to go. And then all of a sudden I say, let's move the one in the middle. Keep in mind that most enterprises start with 72 different SaaS services that need to be interconnected with all their internal services and microservices. This creates what I call a glue problem. And as we talk about this, this means that the API for the microservice needs to be an abstraction. Anything that's tightly coupled to a system is basically that system itself. You know, so if I say that I have a database and I make an API, and the API is a direct correlation, that API uses the same keys, it actually uses SQL queries, what I've done is basically said, let's put a layer in front of my API that I really don't need, or from my database, and connect everything directly to the database. The second I decide to change the database, I have to change the API. And this is where, again, I think we're looking at containers and saying, that's why we build containers. That's why we're doing this. We're with the idea that these services are gonna fail. We're with this idea that we can pull these services down, push them back up, change them, and we're not gonna have that problem. In the API world, what we do is we actually put an API in front of an API. We say, okay, let's actually make it so that this is an abstraction so that if we change out company XYZ, we bring in company ABC instead, the only thing we have to change is actually this API layer right there. And basically the service becomes disposable. That's what I think we're all going for, is disposable services. A lot of things we've broken, we started, moved, doesn't matter. And you can deliver user skill sets. Now, on the API side, BigQuery, YAML, Swagger, but why am I jumping into the API side of things? Why am I saying, hey, let's look at APIs, let's look at the glue problem, let's look at that. The reason is because a lot of enterprises got to this point and said, this is fantastic, we solved the problem. Everything is good. We're just gonna use APIs, and we'll use these microservices to go up and down, and there'll be no issues. Because oftentimes these solutions don't get you in trouble at all. There's only one problem with the solution, only one problem with saying we're going to go microservices and go this route. That is, okay, there's some. The first is that we're now increasing the workload on these hosts by at least 10 times. So all of a sudden, the ability to go up and down and manipulate these things starts creating a lot more load. Microservices also have a much shorter lifespan than more traditional services. So we said, now we're going to have a higher load and put more stuff potentially on a server instead of having one service per server. But we're going to make these things change 90% faster. And by the way, that's going to create a churn of more than 100 times compared to where we were before. So we have this super great idea, and it's going to do super wonderful things, but all of a sudden we run into a quick challenge. And that is that all of a sudden the way that we talk to these different services when we try to manage these services is not going to be able to manage and scale with this new style of network. And this idea of going to APIs, which I believe is honestly the right way to go, and you're seeing companies like MuleSoft come to market and enterprises saying, yes, we want to go this route. But again, that leads back to this problem. And you also have hundreds of thousands of containers spinning up and down, making container-specific or centralized firewall security nearly impossible. Rather than saying, okay, we have one firewall that's gonna stop everything, you have all these different services. If one service gets hacked, you're gonna have issues, and you can't really manage that with one firewall. So I'm proud to say that I have not done this, but again, we have a problem here. Again, I think I'm funny. And that brings us to Project Calico, which is a really long introduction here. Project Calico is basically an open source project designed for simple, scalable networking and then dynamic distributed container policy enforcement. What that means is that instead of saying we're going to have one set policy that's going to apply and has to be centralized, it's actually being distributed across the different systems. So Project Calico is 100% open source. Easy to use tooling if you're using Calx is built in. We actually have a great tutorial for using CoreOS. Love working with CoreOS, supports multiple systems. Highly scalable. It's also going to take a layer 3 approach. How many people are familiar with the layer 3 approach? Cool people? Okay. So layer 3 approach basically is going to operate the same way as this thing called the internet. We looked at the internet and said, hey, we think this thing someday is going to be big. We think it might scale. Let's try copying that. We're sort of banking on that still. Traditional systems use what's called layer 2 approach, which is an overlay that encapsulates the data. What that means is that you have a little more overhead, and on top of that, troubleshooting, you have to start debugging, you have to actually go in and try to do a trace route within the packet versus just a straight through trace route. And of course, it's going to allow for both simple advanced policies and products enterprise grade production tested. Again, no relays, no encapsulation, it's going to use the same IP fabric as the internet. And then there's the entire aspect of security. One thing that I think we forget with security is security doesn't exist. What I mean by that is security is more of a state of mind and trying to stop people from getting certain places and stop them in their tracks versus saying, this is absolutely perfect, you can never get in, it's absolutely secure. One of my favorite things was I used to work in law enforcement and we had a call one day for a house that was broken in and this person couldn't believe it, they bought a security system. They had locked all the doors, they had locked all the windows, and then one day when they left their screen door open. Andrew walked right in through the screen door, grabbed all the stuff and walked out. And because they just didn't have that one area taken care of, it was an easy robbery. At the same time, if they had the security system, the screen door, and then they had a pit bull and an angry neighbor and people watching their place, and you start adding all these different things, it makes it far harder to get in, and that's what we're trying to do here. So, containers themselves are basically set behind a firewall with limited access. But if these containers can talk to each other, both incoming and outgoing, what that means is if I get into one container, I can start accessing multiple containers. And if I get into one service, it's like you left the screen door open, now I'm in your house, and there's not much you can do to stop me. But with Project Calico, what you're actually able to do is enforce the policies across them and say, okay, you're able to talk to, A can talk to B, D can talk to C, but they're not allowed to talk to each other. So if I break into D, I can still come in and get through C, but I can't access A and B. So again, we're limiting these things. If you think about the Target POS hack, you know, the person who broke into the contractor would not then have that off access to everything within their system to get all the credit card information. Again, you could do more advanced configurations. You can say, look, A can talk to B, D can talk to C. By the way, D can talk to B, but B can't talk to D, or vice versa. So it'll be able to limit how everything operates. The way Project Calico works, and this is, again, a super quick overview, is if you're using Kubernetes, it's going to use network policy. You simply come in and say, okay, I have ingress. It's really hard to read, but it gives me from, name selector, match labels, in this case, role management UI. And then you simply say, I want to go from the beta. This is going to be the beta for that. And for that, you simply say, okay, now let's allow from these resources to allow incoming and allow namespace label.
Yeah.
Not that's easy to see at all. Oh, there we go. And of course, you can do more advanced policies. So you can actually say, you know, I want outgoing to allow all, I want incoming to allow all, or deny all. Again, it's as simple as saying, I want to allow, I want to deny, destination source. You actually dig in the messages, port IDs, etc. And then, of course, referencing by tag. With that, again, you can do a lot more. You can also say, look, it has to be, again, I'm going to ports, IPs, protocols, it has to be UDP. You can put order to it. So you can actually say, look, we have a number of policies, and policy A will occur before policy B, before policy C, etc. And of course, your destinations with that. So there's a selector down there where you can see it's sent across, and then the very bottom, port 53. So that's where I say problem solved, and I start to shut up and stop talking. Like I said, Matt's going to come in next month. He's going to be far more on the technical side diving in. But as we look at this, we look at what enterprises are facing, look at some of the challenges again. Hopefully this rides a little bit with, here are the security issues, here's the scalability issues, here's why microservices come in and make this so different and offer so many more advantages. But at the same time, you know, implementing continuous microservices, that's going to create a few more issues that we have to look at and solve, and that's where solutions like, let's say, Google Kubernetes Central or Project Calico or Juniper continue to come in. All right, I think that's all I have. I'm going to stop talking, and I'm going to say I didn't tell too many horrible jokes today, so I'm calling this off.
Questions?
Yes, sir.
How is it different from Leaf? What's better, Calico or Leaf?
So I'm not biased at all. No, the biggest difference between Leaf and Project Calico in terms of networking aspects, is going to be the way that it applies. So Project Calico is a pure layer 3 approach, which again means that you're using IP tables, IP routing, BGP. With Weave, you actually have an overlay that comes in. So your data gets put into overlay. With that, troubleshooting becomes a little more difficult. And then you also have the issue of some load and scale issues. We've had people come to us and say, you know, we absolutely love WeaveWorks, it works perfectly, it's fantastic. And that's great. I think it's a great solution, a great company. We've also people said, hey, we tried doing Weave, but it was able to scale with what we're working with. That's why we chose Project Calico. On the flip side, there are things that Weave does that Project Calico doesn't do. You know, so if you need encryption right now, node-to-node encryption, that's something that WeaveWorks would offer that is on our roadmap. So it's depending on what you're looking for, but the biggest difference is going to be the type of networking.
What about performance? If, for example, Kubernetes 1.6, let's say we can handle like 5,000 containers for cost. Mm-hmm. What if I like run this 5,000 with a lot of containers at the moment, on 10,000 containers? Are you able to handle this or?
I think the last test we had was around 1,000 clusters with, I think it was like 10,000, 20,000 nodes. So. Yeah, it should scale typically. And this is actually already in production in several major enterprises. So, you know, companies like eBay, Bloomberg, and a few others.
Yeah, you probably won't get that scale.
And in total, it's the latest test is 20,000 watts available on 5,000 nodes in Kubernetes. So that's like the scaling times right now.
But if you have a bed, then just like 20,000. So I have like on each machine my big tables changes, like this one 20,000 big tables rules.
Yeah, so the way it works, my understanding with the IP tables, and that can go into this far more next month, is that it's going to be categorized and distributed, so that you'll have your IP table that will say, okay, this is the IP group here, and then basically each cluster becomes its own router, each one becomes its own router, and so it hits that and says, okay, now how do I get this router? So it's a very quick operation, just like the internet operates, where if you type an IP, it's going to go and say, okay, I can go here, what's the next best path to get there?
By the way, just to plug a video that I think Alex, the CTO of Calico, did along with the Brian from Beadworks. They did that for the Cloud Native Computing Foundation. There's a webinar, basically, where they're both talking about this networking technology. And yeah, so you can watch that. That's on the, it's linked somewhere on the Cloud Native Computing Foundation's website.
Any other questions?
How's the integration on hosted providers like Azure Container Service or GKE?
Mm-hmm. So,
with layer 3, right? So that might be a problem.
Actually, so with AWS, for example, Heptio just released their Kubernetes Quick Start. With that, it actually includes Project Calico for the networking and security policies, and that is the default networking and security solution for that. IBM also released their open source framework for the setup of Kubernetes system. Again, Project Calico was chosen before that, and then with Azure in their container engine, they just actually upstreamed Calico into the beta of that. I've never used it, so yeah, it plays very well with GCE, GKE, AWS, and Azure.
So in GKE, for example, mm-hmm. I would want to enable it. Like, basically just add policies, add the controller, basically, and then it should work.
Mm-hmm. Yep, so if you're using like a Kubernetes, you just plug in a Kubernetes install it, then like I said, you're going to actually modify the policies on the Kubernetes side.
Yep.
And then, yeah, it should all work. And of course, there's extensive documentation trails on the Project Calico side as well. With that said, by the way, if you look at the Project Calico documentation, you say, hey, this doesn't make sense for, you know, brand issues, please let me know, because we're always working to improve that.
So it's most of the things affected with policies, would it be possible to use it for routing too, so basically having specific pods of specific services be routed outside through one node and one IP. So I can use it as basically an egress localizer kind of thing?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, that would work. Cool. So for whitelisting on the external services, for example, that would work.
Yep.
That would be defined on a policy too.
Mm-hmm. Could just mention egress.
Cool.
Any other questions? So I'm going to put Lexi on the spot really quick because I brought two cats with me. So I'm going to let you give these out because otherwise people like to eat them afterwards in the alley.
Okay.
And then of course we have Tigger's flag back there as well. Any other questions, just let me know. And by the way, thank you guys, you're very kind. This is actually my first meetup talk with Project Calico Tigger, so I'd love any feedback. You know, if you say, hey, that was absolutely horrible, you should never speak again, or maybe you should improve these things. Thank you.